Greetings, sir and sirettes, and welcome back to From the Depths with me, Lathrix. And of course, welcome for the very first time in this season to a place which isn't raining. There is no fog, there are hardly any clouds in the sky, and we can see clearly for the first time in a very long time. Because today, we are in the sandbox mode, because we are building something a little bit out of the ordinary, which I haven't really had much experience with in the past. So it certainly wouldn't be wise to try and work on it whilst in the campaign. We are building a building. We are going to be building underwater spires, but not just underwater spires. Spires which start underwater but then go all the way to the surface and have a host of weaponry on the top and then loads of storage and stuff on the bottom. Now this is basically the start of a supply chain, but at the same time I also want it to be more of a defensive structure. Now in previous seasons I have made supply chain buildings, I think I called it the urchin or something like that, and honestly I wasn't proud of it in the slightest. This time I want to make that a little bit different. I want it to be something where I can look at it and feel, yeah, I did an okay job with this, and we can start spamming it everywhere. So the idea is, again, it starts at the very bottom of the ocean, it will go all the way to the top, at least this main section won't, but eventually the top section will, and then on the top we'll probably have something like a missile launcher. Now, we could make it better by simply having it at the bottom of the ocean, essentially as an underwater turret, which would be ridiculously powerful, add some torpedoes or something, and the Onyx Watch really doesn't have too much to stop us, especially if we then go into shields, and we use the wonderful thing known as the RTGs, and then the electric engines, we could shield a very small structure down here which could then shoot torpedoes. I may do that in the future, but I feel like it's a little bit overpowered. It's really a tactic which would crush the enemy a little bit too fast, and I'm not really happy using it, as it just feels a bit gimmicky, to be perfectly honest. So for now though, let's do this, because at the very bottom, I'm going to add something a little bit curious. Rather than simply make these spires, like I say, just these generic inventory holding things which can then transfer their inventory from one place to the next and thus become a supply line, I also want them to be a little bit more functional. So at the bottom I'm actually going to add a crystal growth tray. So each one of these will be generating its own crystal. As I've noticed, because of our massive use of electric engines and such, we actually need a fair bit of crystal. We are definitely running out of crystal, and I'm now figuring out we have built this in quite a bad place. Perhaps building it on a bit more of a flat land would have been a better idea, because now I can't place this second item. Well done me, as always, being very good at thinking ahead of time. Can I place any blocks here? No? Okay, so what I'm going to do is quickly save this vehicle, because I can't be bothered to redo it. Vehicle 5, even though it's a building, not a vehicle. Destroy all vehicles, including buildings, obviously. And then let's just place that down again, somewhere a little bit more flat. Or on a peak, honestly, because on a peak, it should have all the sides kind of just hanging off the edge. If this doesn't work, I'll skip ahead to somewhere which will. Okay, there we go. So now I can actually place these in. I will endeavour to replace all the single blocks I'm placing now with beams in the future, but for now, let's just keep this there. There we are. And then once again, processed resources, crystal growth farms, and there we are. Now, in the future, I do also want to start creating submarines, which are going to take a lot of crystal, as I don't want them using the standard engines. I really want to go for as many battery-powered vehicles as possible in the season, as I just find them absolutely fantastic. I love the concept of them, and honestly, I just like not having to constantly worry about fuel. It's such a nice idea, and the fact that crystal is completely renewable as well, and honestly very easy to get, kind of just adds a few bonus points there. Now, the one problem with working with stone is the only shape currently available is, well, beams. Beams or regular blocks, which of course a beam is just a block three or four times. Is it four blocks? Yeah, it's just four blocks. So we can't really build anything breathtakingly beautiful, but saying that, my stuff never is breathtakingly beautiful. So the bottom will look something like this. We don't need it to be too big, honestly, because nothing's really going to destroy all this. If we are going to add shielding, which we most likely are, I will ensure that this area is shielded from cannon fire, as it is definitely the most vulnerable. And then from this, we'll start building upwards. Now, the one problem is, crystal growth trays are explosive, which means we are going to reinforce this with metal. I've literally just decided that now, because the explosive nature just makes it a little bit too scary to be put on the base. Now, is that big enough? Is that going to be the size of the base of these things? I think it will be. I don't really want to go too overboard. I mean, I keep saying that, but I keep on thinking perhaps it would be better to go a little bit on the larger side. But I think this will do just fine. And saying that, I also don't really want to spend too much time building this episode. I kind of want to try out the high explosive rounds for the... I've literally just forgot what they're called, the advanced cannons and stuff like that, so we'll see, we will see. And then from there we just go, yay! And we'll literally leave it like this, because, actually no we won't, because I need the ammo storage, but I want the top section to be build depending on where you're building it. So you build to suit the style of your gameplay, to build wherever you want to build, because also the ocean has varying depths. At the moment, in this area, it's actually incredibly deep, but in some areas it's very shallow. So building all the way to the top would mean we'd have to destroy half the building every time we place down this this save, which would be honestly completely pointless and slowly drive me insane. Now where'd I should go with this? Do I want to do this, or do I want to just go down the route of metal here first? I think what I'll do, if I can find the singles, is do this, then this. Honestly, we could be a bit more expensive in metal. We have a lot of metal at the moment. Metal is not our issue. We have been given a very nice resource zone for the Onyx Watch campaign, I suppose, because it is a more difficult campaign than the regular campaign. They did kind of think, they're not going to be building wooden ships right now, so would be nice to give them a little bit of metal to start off with. And really, we have had far too much. That's why I've been able to make so many fireworks. I can actually make another two at the moment without any effort at all, and the fireworks are doing far too well. I was actually hoping they'd do a bit worse, but it turns out even with the engine downgrades, with the engines being a bit broken at the moment, they're still absolutely fine. And then I'm just going to do this, and this will be the base structure, which actually doesn't look too bad. That looks fairly sturdy. Might consider doing this just to add a bit of a reinforcement effect. Won't actually do much, mind you, and it's actually causing it to be a bit more expensive, but it does look a little bit prettier in my honest opinion. Which is the only opinion which matters. Well, to be fair, when I'm building it kind of is, but still... I do take feedback. Okay, so you go there. And I'll probably just leave this, honestly. Might just cover this in metal. Yeah, I am okay with this. This is fine by me. So this is the base structure. So in here we have the crystal growth farms, and then we'd probably want the ammunition here, but the problem is that does make it look a little bit vulnerable. So what we could do... Man, I'm making this way too expensive. Not too bad, actually, yet. Not too bad, especially since... These are going to be a bit more scarce than previous builds for like supply lines. How about if we have four sets, and each of these sets can be something different. So we have one for the engines themselves, one for the RTGs, and then one for ammo, which means we could actually have a second one for RTGs or a second one for the engines, which would make a lot of sense if you were to ask me, which I'm sure you all just have. I'm getting a bit of a bit of deja vu with the urchin. Oh, I'm just going to build this really small supply line. Honestly, by the way, if you ever are playing From the Depths and you want to build a supply line, you can literally just do this. The smallest one possible, one, not natural, where are you? One misc resource, small, a single block. In fact, I don't even think you need that block. This could potentially be a resource transferring building on its own, and you can just make a very nice supply line that way. But I don't like doing that because I think that's really cheap and it looks silly, at least in my opinion. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and just quickly craft these into a couple of rooms of their own, just around the side, and then I'll be right back with, hopefully, a near-to-finished product. Okay, there we go. We've now set up the very basics down here, although I'm not certain I'm happy with the current distribution. So in these two larger boxes, which are here and here, we have our RTGs. Both of the rooms are producing 450 power, so a lovely total of 900. This is of course being stored over here in our battery room, which is all connected to an electric engine, giving us a maximum power output, a maximum engine power output of 1,000. 1143. And over here we have our storage, which is mostly just misc storage boxes, as this is definitely not going to be part of any supply line I've decided, and is going to focus almost solely on being more of a defensive structure. So the only thing we really have left now is the ammunition, and perhaps more battery storage, honestly. So we're going to make it bigger. Yes, indeed, after everything we said, we are going to be making this bigger. So let's actually set the mirror mode correctly. There we are. Thankfully, I did have it off until just now, so it didn't actually affect anything. There we are. Just put all these struts up here, and then these will go to a secondary set of rooms, which many will be batteries, and then the rest will be ammunition storage and the like of that sort of stuff. There we go. Metal blocks there, although we could have done that in beams, which would definitely be more efficient, so that's something else I'll have to remember to come back to. Yay for editing footage and being reminded later. But it's actually one of the big bonuses to recording everything I do. I always notice the things which I want to improve when I'm editing. When I'm actually building, I miss loads of stuff, but I notice stuff afterwards. It's definitely a big bonus, because when you're talking and trying to brainstorm, you miss so many obvious things, at least in my case you do. And then on this side as well. There we are. So now we have those, and we'll just put these up as well, just continuing with metal, I suppose. Because we've kind of just decided this is going to be expensive. And this is where the next set of boxes will go. Can you see why I'm not doing this in the campaign? We would have been attacked about 3 times, and it would have been in like almost complete darkness, which isn't very fun. Actually, we will need to add lights to this. We will definitely add lights, because it will make this look so, so much better. Okay, delete that. What's in the way there, then? Actually, what is in the way? Oh, that there, okay. That was weird. It kind of wasn't showing where it was colliding. There we are. All of you go there. All of you go there. It's actually looking pretty good. I actually really like how this looks. It looks very, I don't know, like ancient fortress, but a bit of sci-fi as well. At least in my head it does, because I'm also thinking about adding the lights and everything and how it's going to look at the end. It now costs almost 30,000 metal, which is actually still pretty cheap. It's still cheaper than a firework. A firework is just over 40,000 metal, and currently about 2,000 crystal or 3,000 crystal because of the new electric engines I've added to supplement the broken engines it's still currently using and definitely needs to be fixed. Will this work? Yes, it will. And where is the corner? There's the corner. That's not the right corner, though. Try again. There we go. I still don't know how to use this properly. I swear one day I'll do it properly. Also, that doesn't even fit. What am I thinking of? I was thinking that was a different type of block. And actually, that looks better, so I'm just going to stick with that anyway. Yay for about 10 seconds of your life just being wasted. I do somewhat apologize, but not really. Okay. Yeah, I'm happy with that. If we can shield it all, then that'd be fantastic. Now, there is a question, though. I tend to prefer the batteries being in one giant block rather than being separated, so we could, just on this side, just fortify this, and then run the batteries up into this segment as well, and that would be a load more storage all attached to the same engine. And that would probably be the better idea, at least in my head. I still haven't tested out batteries in terms of what's better, having the power in multiple places and having multiple engines, or having one giant engine powering everything. Also, I couldn't find a good forum post about it, and I normally don't read forum posts, but I was being so confused about this, I actually decided, okay, we'll have a look-see, and I couldn't find anything, so I need to do a test at some point just to see which one is actually better. Because I've also had people telling me both ways, so yeah, not exactly too sure about that. Just go mental here. This is going to be loads of power. There we are. We now have 81,000 power storage potential. And that should be a lot of engine power. Almost 2,000, 2013, 2045, 2077, and continuing onwards like that. So this will all need to be reinforced, because currently, as we can see, we have this lovely bit of battery just sticking out there like, please hit me and disconnect half of my power source. That would be fantastic. I'm sure at no point this defensive structure will need power. And because I think it will look weird. Otherwise, we're going to also do this over here, because, again, it's going to look weird if one side is fully connected, then the other side isn't. Actually, we could do this. There we go. Same number of blocks, but a bit more in terms of health. And we'll do the same on that side afterwards. So there we go, and now I'm just going to go ahead and add the ammunition. Okay, so there we are then. We now have the basic ammunition stores and the basic shielding. Now, I was going to add a bit more ammo and potentially more shields, but two things occurred to me. First of all, we can't add more shields without running out of energy. These are currently strength 4, and I refuse to go any weaker. I also refuse to make them any smaller, because this kind of interlocks really well, and does defend the most vulnerable sections, and all of them, pretty darn well and evenly, with a few exceptions in these corners, but honestly, if a shot's coming at that trajectory, it's just very unlikely to be fired anywhere near this tower, so it's not going to happen all that often. Most of the shots will be coming at us like this, and from the top section like this, and this covers it pretty well. I might look into changing that in the future. Now, when it comes to ammunition, I didn't want to add any more because A, it's an explosive problem, and B, each of these towers are going to be customized when I put them into the campaign. None of them are going to be perfectly the same, although perhaps I'll make some prefabs, so some towers might not need that much ammo, so why add extra redundant ammo to each of them? So this is just the base, and I'm pretty happy with it, so we're going to be saving the vehicle as, for now, I'm just going to call it Spire. Perhaps I'll call it the obelisk or something in the future, I really don't know, but there we are, the very basics is now done. It's basically a stump in the bottom of the water. If we wanted to be a bit more cheap, I would simply remove all these little pillars, I suppose, and add a giant torpedo launcher down here. It would definitely be very effective against 99% of the Onyx Watch, since I think they have only one flyer. And that's why we need to go to the campaign now and change our flak weapon into something that actually does well against ships. Not against flyers. Well, here we are in the campaign, and you may notice something a little bit different. I'll give you a second to realize what it is, and then I'm going to talk about it. 1 second has now passed. It's bright. It's naturally bright. I have no filter on. I have no weird contrast settings. It's just stopped raining. It's beautiful. And the reason is, the lovely people over at From the Depths, who are frequenting the forums and such, actually listen to feedback. That's one of the massive benefits by having a huge player-based community, which does a lot of the work in terms of the ship designs and the campaign designs for the official releases. They listen to responses far quicker than a normal development team tends to do so, and so, because of the amount of people talking about it, it's got fixed! The new starting area, well, the same starting area, is now no longer rainy, which means we can see what we're doing without me having to add weird contrast settings and stuff during editing. Isn't that just fantastic? So, I'm currently building a little bit because, as we discussed a while back, we need more crystal, and it turns out we're actually producing crystal far slower than I originally thought. So, underneath this weird metal block I've just made, we have an upside-down growth farm, which I'm definitely going to make bigger as time goes on, and definitely add more to the overall fortress as we have more resources to do so. But this area on top, I'm going to reinforce a fair bit, because sadly growth farms are explosive, and we're going to be adding this as a secondary missile silo, since missile silos just do really well with absolute minimum effort, which is definitely my type of style, to be perfectly honest. There we are. I'm a fairly honest chap. So there we are. That will become a missile silo eventually, and we'll armor it up like all the side here when that time comes. But for now, we need to change our shell type, because it just isn't good enough at all. The flak cannons are just nowhere near good enough for what they were doing, and honestly, why do we have a timed fuse? It's just, I don't know what I was thinking, honestly. I looked back on the last video, and the reasons I gave were somewhat decent. Oh, you know, I want to make a nice roundabout shell that works decently. I know how flak works, but it's just not going to work against super heavy armored enemies. So instead, we're going to go for the there we are. For the HE warheads, which means we're now doing a fair bit more damage and the explosion radius is bigger, or, and this is a big ore, we could go for a bit more of a silly option and go for something like the Sabbath head, and then perhaps, where are you? The, I know it's not actually pronounced Sabbath, I just can't remember right now how it is pronounced, so I do apologise, I'll look it up afterwards. The AP warhead, let's just call it that. So with this, each shot will have an expected armor pierce of 37.3 and will be doing 9.23 kinetic damage. It's also going to be a ridiculously quick shot. So this is going to do massive damage to anything it hits and is going to be going through pretty much everything. In other words, it's going to kill AI and weapon systems. And should be fairly effective. Now the problem is right this second until we respawn the vehicle, it wouldn't have those shells loaded, as I do want to actually fire one of them. We're back! I can't wait until I can remove all these horrible little engines I've put down, because I was panicking on the previous episodes. Hello! Oh, wow, these things are quick! Ooh, armor piercing is lower than expected, though. Armor piercing 26.2. Are you shooting shots smaller than I originally thought? I thought I set you to... Yeah! Then why is your armor piercing lower than it's stating here? 100mm, 100mm. Yeah, that should have been... It's actually a bit weaker than I originally thought. Why is it weaker? This is definitely the right shell. Wait. That looks really small. Oh, of course, because the gunpowder element no longer fires, well, actually shows in the shell, does it? Oh no, it's raining! But it's stopping raining. It must be because my camera was over there with the shot. It kind of decided that was our weather. Okay, it's okay, we're okay. The rain isn't back yet, boys and girls. We're completely safe. Why is that different? Okay, I need to learn something here. Shell diameter, 100, so it's 100mm, that's what I'm shooting. Which means this should be what I'm firing. Unless, aha, that's what it is, our barrel isn't long enough. Optimum barrel length is 12.8 meters. This is nowhere near 12 meters because each single barrel section is 1 meter. So if we go to the advanced cannons, we can go to the barrels, there we are. Actually, it's the right way. So how many do we have already? So I don't think this bit counts, I'm not sure, but either way, let's just not count it to be safe. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, oh, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 to be safe again. So now, if I can actually control my character, fire! There we go. Whoa, that is quick. Okay. That is definitely going to work much better than the last turret type. So now, what I want to do is actually have more of these turrets around. So, I'm tempted to add a bit more armor to the side here than add another one of these turrets because it's just good, consistent damage. Or, I could focus on building one of those towers I just created in the sandbox mode and spent like 20 minutes, well, a lot more than 20 minutes actually building, but about 20 minutes worth of footage building. I'm not sure. For now, though, I think it'd be best if we just save the game, speed up time, and wait for an enemy to attack so we can test out our weaponry. You, Mr. Firework, need to repair, so come back to base.
Moving out.
This may not be the best time to check this out, considering there's already a large force heading towards us. I mean, we have been in the campaign for at least 6 minutes now, but there's a resource zone just on the horizon, and honestly, it doesn't look too far away. So as soon as we make a couple new forces of our own, as I do want to make a submarine whilst in the campaign, and perhaps a new ship, we are definitely moving over here to take over this resource zone. Once we have two resource zones, we are going to be able to produce so many ships so quickly. We will probably be in a really good state to just be overall offensive, especially once I build some more of those towers to defend the areas we already own. So the main issue right now is they massively outdo us in terms of resources. What I should have done is send in my fireworks to hold up one group and then have the other group fight afterwards, because right now I can't really send in much of my force. I can send in everything except for our fortress, and of course the fortress is the thing I currently want to test out. So I'm going to have to put the fishing hole as the very, very final thing to spawn in, because honestly, I think that four fireworks and a rapier will probably do better than the single fortress, even if the fortress is very powerful. That's the problem with having the fortress at the moment, being so large. It's got a very large block count, so we can't really spawn in much with it, at least when we're outnumbered in terms of block count. So, begin the battle, I suppose, and let's see how this goes. Putting a lot of stock in the fireworks, even though one of them hasn't had their AI set up yet, as you can probably tell by the fact it isn't moving properly. There we go. Now go turn on. It's a lot of AI. Well, sorry, a lot of EMP, but that's not really that effective right now. Oh, if any of those hit, that's going to hurt so much. Thankfully not. Okay. Look at how many enemies I haven't even spawned in yet. Okay, there goes the rapier. The rapier instantly blew up because it just took a massive volley from this behemoth. Oh, AI dead from one of the enemies. Fantastic. I could be trying to capture these, but I really don't think that would be in my best interest. Actually, I probably just could. Okay, rapier, I'm going to spawn on you for a second. Hello. Oh, look. A handy hole for me to die in. Well, that's great. I was going to jump out of there. Come on, flyers. Now, the flyers do have the advantage, of course, of simply being a flyer. Oh, my lord, look at how many shots that thing shoots! That's so cool! I need to try and do that with the cram cannons at some stage. Yep, we're now going to view the battle from the viewpoint of being in the water. Missiles are doing very well. The fireworks currently are still suffering from having very weak engines. They're so much slower than they should be, so shots can still hit them. Okay, you're too damaged. You're already dead. Where's that really cool one? So it's you two over there. I'm guessing you're the Iron Cross, because I haven't seen you before, as I don't think I have. I could be wrong, though. Every time we kill an enemy, they're just going to spawn in more, though, so it's nowhere near over just because we're getting the upper hand in this fight. Okay, I'll just skip ahead until I'm actually on board. This is going to take a while. Yar har har. Pirate Lathrix is here to board you, matey. Give me a booty. Booty. Yep. Hello. Okay, we're kind of on. Does this count as being on? I don't think it does. Okay, nope. We're stuck. Aha! And this looks really vulnerable. That's explosive. Detonating the beauty. Oh, wow. Whoa! Chain reaction! That was easier than expected. We just took out almost all the guns, not five shots. Oh, wow. You've hit one of my fireworks. How dare you? Okay, hello, hello, hello. Where is your AI systems? Well, that's just begging to be shot. This is so vulnerable. This whole thing is like an explosive barrel. It's glorious. If I had an AI system in here, I'd probably put it down here, but I don't know how they've been building this. It's still definitely the easier section of the Onyx Watch. Having things built like that, being so vulnerable, kind of shows that. Oh, hello, we have another enemy nearby, which is being shot at, which is bad for us, because we may die in the crossfire. Steering wheel, but no AI. I have no idea where the AI is. Doo-dah, doo-dah. If I was an AI system, where would I be? Probably not on a ship. Aha! Okay, it's actually underneath the main sections. Let's get back up to the top. Okay, that may have done it. Did I just do it? Okay, so I had to skip a lot of the recording there because for some reason the game just froze on me, but yep, I went through and we now have this vehicle. This vehicle is ours. We have an Iron Cross. No, this is the Strausland. Wow, very cool. Then what on earth is the Iron Cross? Is a good question. This one's ours and I'm going to take it out of the fight because I don't really think this is going to be very good in fighting right now. Can you withdraw these forces? I don't know how that actually works. Oh, you, ah! Traitor, fire! Fire, my lovely traitor brethren. Oh, we have no ammo left. Okay, bye. Have fun. Two damaged. Oh no, it's going to die. It's going to die. Oh no, it's being sustained by repairs. If I stay near it, we'll keep it. Oh my lord, they do so much damage, they actually hit the target. The fireworks really are making it a little bit embarrassing sometimes. Just, they clearly don't deal with flyers very well. And I feel so cheap for doing so. I promise I will be making new types of vehicles soon. Wow. I so wish I could have spawned in the flagship as well. This lovely thing, the fishing hole. Increase these forces to, no, if we increase it to maximum, wouldn't that perhaps downgrade out other ones? There's an enemy which is currently too damaged. Can I capture it by any chance and get its resource? I did just capture it, just changed colour. Which means when it gets destroyed, it should have more resources, at least I believe so. We're getting a load of resources. So what are you then? Are you the Iron Crux? I'm just kind of looking at each enemy now, trying to figure out which one's which. We're definitely winning though. There's a Strawsland, an Iron Cross, and an Essen currently alive. They currently still have the advantage in terms of force points. They have 25.3k, we have 17.4, although they're going down rapidly. We're sinking into the wood. Okay. Thank you for accepting me into your wood. Okay, that sounded really odd when I actually said it out loud. I was thinking, oh, it'll sound fine. Oh, you're adorable. Seriously though, what is the vehicle I'm currently on? I can't figure out where I am on the darn map. How about if I just do this? Whee! And actually look at the battle for a second, that'd be nice. I promise next time we'll be a bit more... Oh look, our thing's up and running. Never mind, I'm not talking anymore. I'm just watching my cannon actually do its work. Trying to look out for the blue shot. Yeah, I just saw a blue shot go straight through, so yeah. The armor-piercing rounds are doing exactly what they should do and going through the enemy. Ah, wonderful. I think we're doing a pretty good job, honestly, this campaign. I'm kind of chuffed how well we're actually doing. It's hard to see the shots, though, from the advanced cannon. Okay, there's one. Yeah, it went straight through again. I don't know if that'll pick up, though, on the recording very well. It's very, very fine little blue lions. Oh, they are firing our fortress. And yes, I am realizing that this thing keeps freezing. Yay, from the depths. The laser is disappointing. The armor-piercing rounds, though, are doing very well. Every time I see it hit a target, it's going straight through. Against more heavily armored targets, that's going to do really well. Where does brute force won't win the day? Where am I? Oh, I'm on this one. Oh, that's good. Come on, I'm Pirate Lathrix, don't kill me. I am the Pirate Lord! Don't kill your master! I am in charge here! Okay, this is gone. Oh no, we captured it last second. No, we didn't. Oh, I thought that yellow was our yellow, but no. So there's only one enemy left, and that is an Essen. So this was the Iron Cross, okay. The Strawsland definitely looks the coolest. And because I captured it, perhaps I'll have the blueprints. Oh, one of our flyers got downed at the end. And that is pretty much that. Sorry for the chaotic battle there, though. Fantastic. Wait, I have an Iron Cross? When did I capture an Iron Cross? Oh, of course, yeah, I captured it at the very end. Wow, several of the fireworks going down. Talk about last-minute kind of deaths there. One, two, three of the fireworks are currently in the water. And is it... Nope, that one's going... Okay, this one has repaired enough to get back into the battle. Is this one repaired enough? It's a bit weird to watch them when they first go out of the water because of the automatic systems we have in place. Okay, so two of them repaired enough. The third one apparently took so much damage it just hasn't got the resources to repair. Wow. That was a battle. Okay, much happier with the advanced cannon, even if it is less obvious where it's doing damage. It is going straight through the target, which isn't too surprising considering it has a ridiculous AP value. Can I fire up my own vessels? Okay, it got through two pieces of metal, destroying the first and just going through the second, but... See, that's okay, honestly. If each one of these shots destroys a single piece of metal each, and that's a metal beam, then that's a lot of damage. And if we have more of them, because remember, this is a very cheap turret, that's going to be really good, so I'm happy enough with that. Let's just pull all, get our firework group together again, start repairing them. And do we want to repair the Strawsland? Moves on, see you. So that's the Iron Cross. Wait, you're still alive? Whoa, what the hell's happening to my character? That was bizarre. It's kind of broke.
Water mode at your service.
Yeah, it is a sea vehicle, but yeah, this is broke. Okay, well, that Strawsland has completely broke. So, and now I can't even pull all. yeah, that's a little bit on the broke side of things. But at least we did get an iron cross, which I can repair normally. So I'll repair that, and I'll figure out a way to get this working. And then we'll be back later.